Phillips, thank you for joining me here at the TT. So you've been working for how long for the TT now?
I started full-time right before the 2006 TT. The first one I worked on properly really was the 2007 one.
Was a good one to start at 2007.
Yeah, in some ways, honestly. Yeah. In some ways, yeah.
So, were you already always into bikes, or how did it start
for you? I grew up in Sulby. My mum and dad lived on Sulby Strait on the TT circuit. My bedroom overlooked the circuit, and my dad was and remains to this day a massive TT fan. You know, his main interest in life is motorcycles and motorcycle racing. And I grew up in that world. All of our holidays were to go and see motorcycle racing in Ireland or somewhere like that. And TT for me as a kid was just like better than Christmas. You know, it was the favorite part of the year. So I always grew up in it. Became sort of intrinsically understand it, I suppose. You know, it was always been really important to me, and ended up through that interest and just continually being around it, getting to know lots and lots of people, you know, who were in that world really.
Because what was your career before that?
So when I left school, I ended up working in financial services here, which is what a lot of people do in the Isle of Man, because there's a lot of financial services here. And I was working in an IT job. But at the same time as doing that, I was doing some kind of like freelance work with some TT riders and teams and whatnot, and also with some magazines, doing some writing, helping some people with their PR, helping them with sponsorship and that kind of thing. And it's from that I kind of got the opportunity to do some work on the TT, which I did, a little piece of work. And then shortly after that, then I ended up doing this as my full-time job.
How would you compare the TT from 2006 to what it is today? I
mean, so
it's a broad question. But
yeah, when I started working on the TT, it was at a very low point in terms of there was a lot of pressures to the continuation of the TT at that time. The motorcycle industry in the United Kingdom had become very opposed to the TT, so much so that the Motorcycle Industry Association in the UK were starting to push for the TT to be stopped. And then the wider industry was negative about the TT. There wasn't much media interest. All the kind of, the teams had pulled away from racing, you know, the bigger teams had pulled away from racing in it. There was almost no commerciality. And there was a general feeling at the time, I think, if people could recall, that the TT would maybe get to 2007 and stop, you know. So it was very different. And we're talking about a period of time that is pre-widespread social media use.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the world's changed a lot since then. But already back then, the TT was probably, in my view, being delivered in a way that was already many years out of date.
Mm-hmm.
For 2006, 2007, you know, so there was a lot of quite straightforward work to begin with to try and just pick off some of that low-hanging fruit to get it working better,
mm-hmm.
to start turning the ship around in terms of the perception of it, to try and bring some money back in to service the costs, get the teams back, get some better riders here, get the media reporting about it again. And it's been on a really positive trajectory since then in all those things that we could measure success by.
Yeah,
they've all gone up and up and up, up to the point where we got to the pandemic and the TT was cancelled for 2 years, and that became a fortuitous moment in many respects, because it allowed us to kind of stop, review everything in a way that we wouldn't have had the opportunity to do otherwise, and then come back again last year with a revised proposition really for the event in all areas that I believe is taking us, hopefully take us to another period of sustained success.
I mean, would you say that 2 year period of COVID, that maybe is some like a good thing finally that it happened for the TT?
So it was obviously not very good for lots and lots of people in lots of ways, and locally, you know, for the visitor economy and the hospitality sector, it was very challenging. But in terms of the TT event and its long-term success, I think it was hugely important, and we might not realise how, or people might not understand how so until they look back in 5 years' time or something. But it was probably a once in a career opportunity for the people who work on it to do that in such a way where they could really come out of the or off the conveyor belt of delivery to just stop, say, do you know what, some of this stuff we're doing is not right,
yeah.
You know, or we're not doing it in the right way. And also, you know, like I was talking before, like we were talking about what doesn't seem that long ago, a time before widespread social media use, yeah. or even widespread access to the internet, you know. And then now we're in a very connected digital world that's changing hugely, and to survive as a brand, to survive as an event, to survive as a business, the TT needed to be doing some different things, and that period allowed us to make that change. And right here, right now, I mean, we're sat in this room here, which is just one of the rooms that people are working from at the TT, and we're absolutely surrounded by cameras, batteries, microphones, yeah. equipment, which is kind of ironically indicative about where we are now. You know, we're making so much content and targeting audiences all around the world, not just during the event, but all through the year. That's a big change and also a big priority for us moving forward.
I mean, working in media myself, of course, it's something I have a really close eye on. I mean, the media strategy that the TT have done since, 2 or 3 years, I think it's brilliant. It's second to none. Is that something that you actively are involved in, and is it something that you are proud of as an organizer?
Absolutely so. You know, there are lots of things with the TT that still require improvement. But the one thing that is genuinely world class is the spectacle,
yeah.
The TT therefore lends itself very well to the age of mass video consumption, you know, and yeah. YouTube and TikTok and things like this. It's ironic that these such sort of new technologies are so useful for an event that's so historic, but. We have a real opportunity that maybe some of our competitors don't have to put our event in front of new audiences because it's so spectacular, using those platforms. And if you work with people with real talent, which we are doing, we're very lucky to have assembled a team both internally and externally, a number of the contractors we work with who make content with us and for us, to be able to gain an advantage. And the audience growth we've seen in the past 18 months, let's say, and what we can see going forward, starts to take us to a really different place in terms of the other events that we can kind of start to stand shoulder to shoulder yeah. with, in terms of audience size and the commerciality that comes from growing an audience. And it's really important because the TT does have gaps both generationally and territorially, and that can't be ignored and can't be left unaddressed if we want to be here still doing this in 10 years time or whatever. So it's really satisfying to see that chain of content kicking in, you know, because you can see these comments set against the content we make, whether it's on YouTube or elsewhere, where people are saying this is fantastic.
Yeah.
I'd like to go to this event. I want to see more about this event. And you can see it happening in real time. You can see the kind of the farming of fans, you know, finding people who are new to it or not seen it, and bringing them along from no interest to mild interest to moderate interest to lots of interest, and eventually being, you know, boots on the ground, like a visitor or a live pass holder or whatever, you know, and contributing to the future of the event. So and we do have a very detailed strategy that sits across 7 years for this, we believe it's a very strong strategy, and it's working. You know, we're actually ahead of schedule on it after the first 2 years. And it's really exciting. I believe currently that, you know, we're making some of our content, albeit made with a much smaller budget and much smaller team than some of the big players in our space, like Formula One and MotoGP. I think ours is as good as, if not better at times.
Yeah, I would definitely agree. I mean, I've seen all the documentaries and the series and the movie as well. With the life pass thing, I mean, that's such a huge undertaking with the track being 37.75 miles. You must, to be able to convince, well, especially the government being the promoter, you must have been like, had to make a very good case of convincing them, okay, we're going to do this.
Yeah, because it's a risky strategy. You know, there's an outlay without a guaranteed return. And live has been a conversation around TT for a long, long time, as you probably imagine. And personally or individually, I was always very opposed to it up until the point that we've done it, because there's been lots of people who have come forward and said, we would like to do live and we'll do this and we'll do that. And the reason I was always opposed to it is because if we're going to do it live, it needs to be done well. We've got a really spectacular, visceral event. And the worst thing we could do with that is deliver it to new people for the first time in a way that didn't show it properly. So we've arrived at a point last year where, from a cost perspective, it was achievable to do it well. And from a technical perspective, it was achievable to do it well. And what I mean is, that means that we had the ability to do it with lots of cameras, with two heli, which is really expensive for 2 weeks, with a full production team of which is about 150 people strong, with access to a lot of presenting talent, you know, to cover the whole thing of scope of the event, studio on-screen graphics package, you know, a proper broadcast that new fans would expect. It would be easy to exceed the expectations of existing fans if we went from not live to live, because that would be a step forward. That was more than what they were used to. But for people who come from watching F1 or MotoGP or any sport, actually, who are used to a good live product, if they were to come and see the TT for the first time and to be substandard, that would have been a difficult challenge then to overcome going forward. So it had to be a good standard from the outset, and I believe last year's was a good standard. I believe this year's is quite a big step up. Mm-hmm. It's finessed a lot, you know, we've improved lots of little things. And financially, it exceeded its target in the first year, and it's already exceeded its target in year two. And what that does is it makes the TT accessible, much more accessible. So now anybody with internet connection can watch all of it. Mm-hmm. You know, the only barrier is a relatively small price point.
Yeah. Was that always the target, to keep it really low?
Yeah, eyeballs over income. Or eyeballs first. Income will come, the more eyeballs, the more income. Yeah. And then in terms of income, it delivers an income stream which pays for the production and delivers a significant and growing net return back into the event for us to, you know, service or other costs from. So, so far, a really great start. And timing's everything. So, you know, in sport, fans are becoming increasingly used to getting their content that they like direct from the sport itself, you know, going over the top of broadcasters, you know, and that wasn't the case even pre-pandemic, really, you know. And
the only thing, the way you could watch it was ITV4.
Yeah, but I mean, even with other sports, you know, there was still, right now, more and more sports are basically making their own sport and putting it on their own platforms, you know. And obviously it's a longer game, because you don't have the audience of the broadcaster that comes with, but you know, we're already at 220,000 subscribers to that channel now, I think, which after a year for a niche one event sports channel, it's all right, it's okay, it's good, you know. And hopefully, based on the strategy of creating content all of the year and continuing to communicate with new and existing audiences, you know, that number's just going to continue up. And the good thing about that is that the costs of delivery are unlikely to rise a lot in the short term.
Yeah.
So the benefit back to the event is you know, will grow year on year, I believe.
This year there's a new schedule, of course. Mm-hmm. How have you seen that so far?
So, to bring the new schedule forward for such a traditional event as the TT, and one that impacts this island so much, was a challenge. You know, it's taken a long time, and we've had to overcome some opposition. I think maybe no matter how much you try and explain the rationale for doing something like this, you know, some people just either won't absorb that rationale or can't understand it or find that irrelevant. But I believe that the schedule was changed, was driven out of real logic, and I think it's played out this way this week. Each component part was carefully configured to make sure that people weren't being overloaded, whether that's riders, officials, marshals, medics, etc. And the days have been quite short. There's been lots of recovery time in between the bits.
Yeah.
The schedule, the way it's been constructed, where you know sometimes the slower bikes are used first, or there's more activity in the daytime rather than the evenings, and the time off between each component part has been increased. I think that's really helped. Obviously, everyone's going to say, well, the weather was really good, so yeah, that's why it worked.
The opportunity to actually follow the schedule.
Yeah, and everyone's going to say, well, it only worked because the weather was good. It was like, yeah, that's fine, but you work from the place where you do whatever the best version of the event you can achieve, and then deal with the cars that you dealt with. And if we had a lot of bad weather to contend with, we would have moved the component parts around. I don't think people understand quite how much flexibility we've got in the period of time we've got to deliver the event, which is a lot. And also, obviously, putting an event on at the start of the summer gives us a fighting chance with the weather anyway. So the schedule has been a real success, in my opinion, in terms of the competitors have enjoyed it from my feedback so far, and the teams. The fans seem to be enjoying it, you know, anecdotally based on what you read and hear. I think economically it's been very good. Time will tell. We will properly understand that in due course. You know, we will do a lot of research around that. But I think the Bank Holiday Monday was a lot of people were doing stuff. The middle weekend when we had, particularly the racing on the Sunday afternoon, was really like, it felt like a really major event with a massive crowd. Obviously, we're going to finish on another Saturday coming up, and you can see it from the audience drop off in midweek. You know, it's not a massive shock to see that less people are engaging when they're at work, yeah, versus the people, you know. And there's also some evidence from the airport where they're seeing a change in some of the habits and some of the trends in terms of more people coming in or new people coming in now for the end, which hasn't been the case before. And ultimately, that's why the event exists. The event exists to bring people to the Isle of Man. It doesn't exist for any other reason. And if we can improve the benefit that it brings to the local economy, then that's success. That's what success looks like. So I think the schedule will consider it post-event, will consider all of the implications and the feedback. But I believe it needs more than 1 year, yeah, to be fully understood, and I would suspect that next year we'll have a similar schedule.
Something we need to touch on is, of course, there will always be some negativity, especially around outside our own bubble, let's say. And the mainstream media will always pick something that they want to shoot on, let's say.
Yeah.
How do you deal with that on a professional level, but also on a personal level? I mean, it must.
Both are a challenge. On a professional level, I think if I didn't work on the event, it would still happen. You know, the event doesn't happen because of me, you know. And the role that I can play is that I can help, hopefully, or my contribution can be to make it better, and provide and you know, raise income and other things that will help the race organisers reduce the avoidable risks more and more and more. And the past 2 years, the investment that's been made and the changes to procedures and things that have been made has been the biggest step up in all the time I've known the TT. And I believe that will continue next year and the year after and the year after. And the kind of proactive culture that exists there now is the most proactive it's ever been, I think. And that's something to be. That's something that I'd like to be involved in, and I do believe, you know, there is an inherent risk with what we do, and that is uncontrollable. But there are lots of things that we can do, whether that's better use of technology, whether that's better use of sports science, whether that's changing rules, procedures, that we can, you know, we achieve a better outcome on that. In terms of personally, I've been around the sport all my life, so I understand the risks, I understand the implications of it, but that doesn't make it any easier, nor does that normalize the emotions, you know. And it's very, very, very difficult. But like I said, if I said it's just not for me and I don't want to be involved, it'll still be happening next year with somebody else, you know. So I rationalize that off personally by thinking, well, I will try and make a positive contribution to do as much as possible and to help this be the best it can be.
All the things you just mentioned about all the stuff that's happening to, you know, improve the event, do you feel like sometimes that point is missed by especially people from the outside? They don't realize that all the things that happen to
on the outside and the inside, actually. So on the outside, it's a difficult conversation anyway, you know, to say that we're doing all this stuff, because it takes time to really understand the event and what the things that we're doing mean. You know, I think if we're going to put an event on that's very dangerous, we want to be the best people at managing something that's very dangerous and doing a huge amount of stuff. But internally, it's a real challenge as well, because there's a culture in this sport of normalizing risk and accepting probably or definitely too much risk at times. Yeah. And to make changes, whether that's been reducing the number, you know, we've made changes that are quite hard to deliver and there have been a lot of resistance to, whether that is, you know, reducing the number of people that can compete here, whether that is enforcing higher standards of kit, you know, personal protective equipment, both for the riders and their crews, greater restrictions on where people can spectate, you know, higher scrutiny around things like drug and alcohol or all these things, you know, all of them, they're quite hard to, you know, even the sport itself resists that sometimes. And I think that will get easier the more we do, the more it gets normalized. And I do think that we are seeing green shoots of greater professionalism across the TT, but it's not easy to deliver. You know, it really is a challenge to deliver, because it's such a traditional event, and you know, there is a kind of mindset of, you know, back in the day they did this and that was okay. But this is 2023, and if we want to be here in 2024 and 2025 and 2026, we have to do better.
Finally, Paul, how do you see, maybe it's a bit of a broad question again, but how do you see the long-term future of the event, and also yourself being involved or perhaps not involved in the event?
The long-term future of the event, I see the TT remaining currently on the current trajectory that it's on, being an important event in motorsport, being an important event for the Isle of Man and the visitor economy, and in order to continue to fulfil that, I believe that it will need to continue to evolve. So, you know, we spoke a lot about changing stuff, and I think whilst that's hard, I think it's going to have to continue to do that and to remain relevant and to manage all of the challenges that it's got, not least the financial pressures, which are only going to go one way. You know, it's only going to get more expensive. Personally, I've had a number of ups and downs with since I've worked on this event in terms of my own feelings towards it. At the moment, I'm really enjoying what we are doing, and I'm really enjoying working with the people across all aspects of the event, my own team, but also the other teams of, you know, the race organisers and the marshals and the medical teams and all the teams commercially that we work with and whatnot. And then I feel really happy working on it at the moment. But I haven't given any long term thoughts to that at the moment, what that means for me. But I certainly hope to still be contributing in some way next year.
Well, Paul, I've been here for the last 2 years now, and I must say that I'm really impressed. So,
I very much appreciate that.
Hope to be back next year and see the event evolve for the better.
Thank you.